welcome you to this centennial event. And I have to say, this is purely the gift of Krista Tippett. It's her loving gift to us, really, in honor of Mel Hosley and Ray Anderson, who are such dear, dear friends of hers. I don't think Krista really needs any introduction. Certainly not. You know that she's the creator and the host of a Peabody Award-winning program on reading, which was originally called Speaking of Faith. It was awarded the National Medal of Humanities a couple of years ago, and is the author of three books, two of which are right here. And the format is going to be the following, that we'll have a conversation with some questions that about topics that I've gleaned from some of you for your suggestions. And I know you all have questions. So we will talk. For me and for I know many of us here, your writings and your programs are really reliable sources of spiritual inspiration. And renewal. And I know people in the audience here find other forms of renewal as well, worship, nature, music. And if it's not too indiscreet, I'd like to know where you go for renewal and refreshment, spiritual renewal and refreshment.
One of the interesting things about this age we inhabit is that we are free to craft our spiritual lives. And I think that's even true for people who are planted in traditions. Mm-hmm. We supplement it in so many ways. Something that's become really important to me in the last few years is my yoga practice. I actually do believe that if everyone did yoga, we could probably solve all these problems. as this yoga teacher once said to me, just get all these world leaders breathing together. And it makes sense, right? There was a long period of time where I read Compline and the Upon Prayer. These days I have a morning kind of contemplative practice that I've gone in and out of, and then I keep coming back to realizing it's not optional. we've been cobbling something together, just like everybody else. I think the conversations I have are so nourishing for me, right, and so educational.
An inquiry into the mystery and art of living. And in your in the National Humanities Medal citation, you were celebrated for thoughtfully delving into the mysteries of human existence. Mm-hmm. And again, our sense of the mystery that is engaging us obviously changes. Can you share some idea about hints about where what mystery might be most kind of intriguing or life-giving to you right now?
Well, I want to say something, which is we were speaking earlier about how Mel Hosley really is part of the reason that my show exists, because of the encouragement she gave me. And it was such a hard sell in the early 2000s to say we're going to talk about this religious and spiritual part of life. And when I won the National Humanities Medal and I read that citation, thoughtfully delving into the mysteries of human existence, I felt like, we are growing up. It was a big deal that in a place like the White House, culturally, because the 20th century, I think, and I actually think we're dealing with the aftermath of this now also in places like the White House, we tried to banish mystery. And we pretended like we were rational and we just come up with the right system and things we can count, that's what matters. And we just keep relearning that we are very strange and illogical and beautiful and unpredictable and mysterious. And I love my conversations with scientists. I feel that scientists, well, I feel that the religion I grew up with, which was Southern Baptist, mystery had to be contained. It was in the vocabulary, but you didn't want too much of it. I actually feel that that scientists have a very expansive. It's not just that they have a vocabulary of mystery; they take delight in it, and that doesn't necessarily mean that they imbue it with transcendent meaning, but they are just very happy to stand before it and to be in awe and to be excited that we have things to learn and to be excited when what we thought we knew turns out not to be true. Because what an adventure to figure out what we have to learn next. And so I actually have had this feeling that, scientists, and I think especially physicists, are keeping the concept of mystery alive now in a way that our theologians, as a group, are not, which is so interesting to me. That said, I believe my sense is that mystery, yes, there is this vast mystery of the cosmos, but I think mystery is an ordinary experience of the everyday. It's a common human experience, like falling in love and being born and dying. And so I want us to embrace its vastness, and I also think it's important to acknowledge how ordinary it is.
I've been recently inspired by the Reverend Dr. William Barber II's moral movement.
Yeah.
Just tuning into that. I mean, of course, I heard about moral Mondays, but who else do you think is doing good work on a moral agenda?
There are so many people doing good work.
That's great.
And we just don't wait that. In the same way, when we tell the story of our time, right? And the story was in the news today, which is all true. Well, it's not all true. As we know, it's not all true. But there are some facts involved. I do think we're in a moral crisis. I don't think that's a very original thought. I think it's a moment of reckoning. And all through last year, my thought was about, the thing that felt most urgent to me was whoever won, we were going to have to reweave common life and reinject moral imagination, but that it's not going to happen from the top down now. And I don't think it would have if Hillary Clinton had won. I mean, it just the tenor of where we are collectively, and there's something really deeply broken and dysfunctional about our national political process. And that's unsettling because that's the place we want to look to see the way forward. That's where we want to look for leadership. That's where we want to tell our children they can look for leadership. That's not true. That's the bad news, and the aspect of that which I feel we have to embrace as a calling is that it is up to us to weave the new realities we're going to inhabit. And I do see people doing that everywhere, and they have been doing that everywhere. And it's just, it's not, I think that that moving forward, it's important that it's happening at every level. It's happening inside families and in neighborhoods. and in communities like this, and in workplaces, which also are public life. So, there are people we can point at like that who have, and there's so many of them. I was on the phone today with John Powell, who's at Berkeley, who's doing this conference in April called Othering and Belonging. And that's the frame in which they're looking at the work we have to do. What we have to write, you know, we have to humanize all of these challenges. I talk to people every day. I mean, this may surprise you, but I've been on the phone with Glenn Beck a few times in the last month. And he's still a conservative, and he's Glenn Beck. And he's the first person to say that. But he is somebody who, from a very different place on our spectrum, has been reckoning with and doing a lot of soul searching about what part did he play in getting us where we are now. So for whatever reason, a lot of people are reaching out to me. So I feel like I have this privileged position to see what's unfolding, and it's so much more interesting. So much more interesting and so much more hope-giving than what was in the New York Times today. Again, that's all true, but it's not the whole story. So I feel like really my answer to that question is we are all creating that whole story.
You know, there's that cartoon, I think it may have been a New Yorker cartoon, it was circulating long before the election, during the primaries. My desire to be well informed is currently at odds with my desire to remain sane. And that's the tension.
Yeah.
That's the tension.
Yeah.
We do have to remain well informed, and at the same time can't allow ourselves to go into this despair over. A long time ago, John Luigi was still editor of Newsweek. Mm-hmm. He spoke to a gathering at the Diocese of Texas, and in the Q&A, somebody asked him about bias in the media, and he said, On the whole, I don't think the media are biased in one direction or another politically, but I can tell you, the media are biased toward conflict.
Toward conflict.
Yeah.
And the vision
has
been, it sells.
It does, and also, somewhere along the way, we started to define news as the extraordinarily terrible thing
that
happened. Yes, right. And then I remember talking to a journalist a couple years ago who was, all of our institutions are reforming and collapsing and reforming, and so there are people thinking about what journalism has to become, and there's something called solutions journalism, where this journalist was talking to me about like social justice journals or something like that. We're going to cover, I can't remember if that's the title, but anyway, a more respectable journalist said, well, that's getting into advocacy. And she said, well, so does that mean that because you only cover catastrophe, you are an advocate for catastrophe? Right? So there are big things we have to rethink and reframe.
Getting back to those divisions, I think a number of people here find themselves living in a parallel universe with people they love, mm-hmm. old friends, family, who are reading the same facts mm-hmm. and seeing a completely different world. Mm-hmm. It's baffling, and of course it's troubling. And yesterday's gospel, of course, was become reconciled, be reconciled to your brother and your sister. Do you have any advice about that?
I was having this conversation yesterday about starting new conversations, and someone said to me, my best friend, my oldest friend, is on the absolute other side of the spectrum, and I cannot find a way to start this conversation with her. How can I start conversations with anyone else? I wonder if in this kind of moment, maybe we don't start closest to home. Because actually that's where it's hardest.
That's interesting, yeah.
Everybody has the brother-in-law. You know what I'm saying? Every family has the brother-in-law. And having said that, but this is a really tricky moment. But I do believe that we have intelligence in our families that we could apply externally. For example, the fact that we all do have people with whom we're in intimate relationship, like circles of family and friends. So let's say it this way, that we know that in our intimate circles, there is a range of how much those people make sense to us and how much we have in common with them, and there are a number of them who drive us crazy. And yet we love them, and we choose to stay in a relationship, and we sometimes do that by knowing what conversations we won't have, the things we won't talk about, to keep the peace, because we love them. There's something in the human brain that when we imagine the other across those lines of family and friends, we imagine a homogeneity that is not there in our circles of family and friends. And so these are really quiet, gentle, psychological moves, but I think, you know, it would help us if we started imagining that in that other group, the people who voted for the other side, there's as much difference among them as there is among us.
Indeed.
I mean, just, I think, softening our imagination about our neighbors who have become strangers. I personally think that right now, and I don't think this is just in immediate circles, I think we have to start, I don't actually think we can start by talking about the things that we're most upset about. What we do have to start engaging around is how to live together. I don't think we're going to have a lot of common ground right now. Yeah, we really want that as Americans. We either want it to be there, or we want to impose it by taking the vote or calling the debate. And, you know, we took the vote. And, this is a challenging thought, but we can't allow, common ground can't be a prerequisite for common life. And one thing I've heard from really wise people I've interviewed across the years who've worked in conflict resolution and worked in creating relationship across difference, is that when you have deep, deep difference, common ground, I mean, here's something, it was Francis Kissling said it to me this way, that the pressure of coming to agreement can get in the way of understanding each other. And we really don't understand each other. What this asks of us is to let go of some things that feel so instinctive, like it's the only way we can do it, which is that we need to talk about what's in the room. I mean, I personally think that one way to imagine starting new conversations right now is not to have the debate or to approach disagreement head on, but to identify some shared questions. So I was in Iowa recently, and a woman told me about being part of a group of parents from their school who were about half, it was right after the election, and you know, about half of them had voted for Donald Trump and about half of them had voted for Hillary Clinton. All of them were really concerned about the effect the election and the discourse of the election had on their children. And so they had decided to come together around that question of how are we going to talk to our children about this and how are we going to move forward. I think that is a really good motto for for continuing to live together and understanding that we just won't agree right now.
And the wounds are so deep and so fresh. Thank you. That's very, very wise. This is a question from Frank Janicich. How do we create the world? Question from Frank Janicich. How do we create the world we want our children to inhabit? And what part does the church need to play? That's a small
The wisest people I've spoken with about parenting over the years gave me the bad news that our children are rarely really listening to us. they're rarely listening to us as much as we want them to be listening to us, and they're always watching us harder than we want them to be watching us. And that, but I think what the relief in that is that us tending to our spiritual life is not selfish. It's not indulgent. We do that on behalf of our children. And us figuring out whatever it means in our adult ways to create new realities and letting them be witnesses to that and be part of that is... So, you know, we don't have to, like, relinquish what our needs are in this moment to do that for our kids. I mean, churches, right now, we have a crisis in this country of people, of where are the trustworthy spaces, right? Politics is not a trustworthy space. Media is not a trustworthy space. You know, when we think about where we do public life, it feels fraught. Parker Palmer has been a great mentor to me, and something he said to me years and years ago has totally formed my work. He said, you know, we're very skilled at bringing many aspects of ourself into our public spaces. We're good at bringing our intellect in, we know how to state an opinion. We're actually pretty good at bringing our emotions into the public sphere. But the soul, the insights of the soul are something different. It will run away if it is cross-examined. It's a very intimate part of us. And he said that for the soul to speak its truths, you need quiet, inviting, and trustworthy spaces. And as I said, the places that come to mind most readily as public life do not have those attributes. But a church does, a healthy church. And I think there could really be a new role for a church as part of a community, as part of public life, just to be this space that is hospitable. Where people can come and gather across differences and just know that they'll be, that it'll be quiet, inviting, and trustworthy. That'll be huge right now.
I think that's one of the charisms of this church. Mm-hmm. Service is one, and community is one. Mm-hmm. And we have a huge spectrum of belief, like all Episcopal churches have been.
Yeah.
Lots of questions, a big spectrum of practice going from the contemplative to. And so I think that's, thank you, because I think it's like all of your deepest spiritual gifts, it's the thing you take for granted.
Yeah.
So having, of course I put it on the banner outside, but this is 100 years of sanctuary service and community, because it is a charism here. I think the people who were brought up here, and there are a number of the pews, take it for granted. And thank you. So that's a role.
Yeah, don't take that
for granted. Into the next century of this sweet space, something we can do. Mm-hmm. And the then suburban bishop of Maryland was arrested for her DUI, hit and run, killing of the bicycle guy. The Washington Post defined for their readers, they had to tell the readers who the Episcopal Church was, as, quote, a small, historically significant denomination. A couple of years ago. And yes, you've got a long history with the Episcopal Church, but the Episcopal Church, of course, has a very long history in this country, right?
Yeah. Other countries.
Exactly. We had to become the Episcopal Church after the unpleasantness of 1776. So, that really was the knife. It's true. We're a small, historically significant denomination. We're a very healthy parish, and we're lucky to be. Do you ever think about, given your history of the Episcopal Church, your theological studies at Yale, your having been a clergy wife, do you think about the role of the Episcopal Church at all? You've articulated some of what the church itself can be, and that's really important. A safe space, and we can be, and yeah. This one is. But maybe you don't even think about the denomination itself, but you have any thoughts about that?
Like everything and everyone, the Episcopal Church has this potential that is just phenomenal. I mean, the Episcopal Church at its best is a place that embraces difference as a creative tension.
By definition.
And even as work of holiness in and of itself. Then each individual church is true to that or interprets that with infinite variety. But that virtue is precisely what the world needs right now. We need less information, we need more discernment.
Yes. Yes.
And I actually think it could be fruitful in a community like this. Not to think what is a new thing we have to do, but to be in discernment of how do we live more deeply into this thing we already are, this thing that is in our DNA.
Thank you. That's a good project for the next century. Of this, next 100 years of this life here. Okay, I know there are questions.
In your book, Becoming Wise, in the chapter on faith, particularly in the conversation with Rabbi Sacks, you express such a profound sense of hope. I'm going to guess that was written before November of last year. Has that sense of hopefulness, I mean, really, about our common future, has that sense of hopefulness been diminished by the election and the result, or the recent actions of the administration?
I think the short answer is no. But what I distinguish between, for me, I distinguish between optimism and hope. And I also do that, and I know some people use the word optimism the way I use the word hope. But so having made that qualification, to me, optimism is kind of wishful thinking. Kind of let's hope it turns out all right. To me, hope that is resilient is reality based. It sees and insists on seeing the complexity of reality, but it sees the whole picture. And I say I am not at all hopeful right now about our political life, but I'm hopeful about just about everything else. And as I say, I know we're all in this together. That's why I'm glad to be here tonight, because I feel like one thing we right now want to be in the rooms with other people talking. It's a heavy moment to bear. That's part of my hope about the moment. We're such strange, contradictory creatures. And a crisis has an ability to draw out the best of us. You know, I really believe that I've been watching us and kind of the world for the last 5 years or so and felt like part of what we were contending with was that the main challenge was uncertainty. Kind of, the ground shifting beneath us. My children's future doesn't look like what it used to look like. Every institution, schools don't make sense anymore, prisons don't make sense anymore, hospitals don't make sense anymore, workplaces don't make sense anymore. But we have no idea what's coming next. And we are actually not hardwired to do very well with uncertainty. It makes us a little crazy. And I actually think, I feel, if it were so horrible, I would say I feel vindicated. Because it really came out that it's just doing us crazy. We are actually hardwired to rise to the occasion of a true threat. And I felt the day after the election, immediately everybody was awake, wide awake, and trying to figure out how to be and how to contribute. There are a lot of terrible things that can happen right now, right? There's a lot that can go wrong. But there was a lot that was going wrong before that we weren't paying attention to. And a big fear I have is that we will allow ourselves to be oriented around things we're reacting against, like perhaps tweets. And not continue. What I really hope for is that we stick with that self-searching. I was aware of so many people in the aftermath of the election really asking, like, why did I not see that? And what did I not see? And it wasn't just about Donald Trump. It was about how out of touch have I been with whole entire parts of my country and whole entire parts of my state and my city. And to me, that if we follow that inquiry, then we're doing the work we needed to do anyway. This, where we are now, is a symptom of that. It's not bringing it about. It certainly has the potential to make things worse, and to make things worse for certain people.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, that's where it's comforting. Glenn Beck is asking himself what part he had. We all need to do that. Every one of us.
Yeah, and he's frustrated. He talks to me and he says, "We need to hear more liberals talking this way." But
what way is that?
More liberals.
Well, just taking some credit for what's gone wrong.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
And I said to him, people are talking this way. He's not reading the New York Times, and I'm not reading the New York Times, and that's one reason they're still driving me crazy. But I say to people like him, a lot of people are doing this.
The David White poem, start and close.
What?
The David White poem, start and close.
Oh, yeah.
Take that first step that you don't want to take.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Who else? Next.
Oh, Heidi.
Heidi? Is it Heidi?
No, it's Nancy. And Rosemary has a question.
In your book, you talked about words, which is a favorite subject of mine, so thank you for that. And one of their sentences was, words make worlds.
Yeah.
So I'd like to know if you could talk a little bit about some of the words that you think might be helpful to us now, or concepts around words that might be turning words or softening words or something like that.
So that sentence, words make worlds, is a Talmudic idea. Boy, I think we have a lot of demonstration of that, I mean, negative demonstration, but the power of words. And I think that we don't, we deal with words so much all day long, and we rarely pause to think how we've all had the experience that somebody can make our day or break our day with a sentence, and that we can do the same thing for other people. A word I find myself using a lot these days is generative. And I find myself putting in front of the word change. Because we certainly have change right now. And all change is not good. And I also, you know, we have the language of resistance is out there now. And I understand it and I honor a lot of it. And I also think we need a biodiversity of words. And so I think for me, you know, resistance and generative change, because as much as we need to resist, we need to be creating. Mm-hmm. We need to be creating those new realities. We're in such a rut. I think one thing we need to do now is develop a little immunity to using the words. It's like we all kind of, words get out there, or ways of using words, or platforms for using words, and we very much follow that. Instead of staying planted. Not just in the words we use, but in the way we use them. I would just say one other thing. I grew up in a small town in Oklahoma. In fact, I grew up, where's my inner Shawnee, Oklahoma?
There
I live. Yeah. there. I know that there are a lot of good people out there on the other side of the political spectrum. And I know there are people who voted for Donald Trump and who didn't do it because they were stupid or misogynist or racist. And people say to me, well, you know, there's, you know, like, there's, well, if they voted for him, they must be those things, or they're condoning those things. And that argument would make sense if we were logical creatures. But we're not. None of us are. And that's not a Republican or a Democratic reality. So I want to say something that makes me really uncomfortable now is, you know, there's the energy to resist what we may be called to resist. There are also, and also, I mean, I'm all for playfulness, and how can anybody be against Saturday Night Live when it's so good right now? But I think there's an element that seems to be seeping into almost everything of making fun. And it feels really dangerous to me.
It's not fun at all.
Because somehow what I want us to be attentive to is not just our president, say, but that behind the fact that he's our president, there are a lot of people who voted for him, and they voted for him for a range of reasons that are very human. And quite a few people voted for him out of despair that is absolutely reasonable and logical. And I don't want them to feel that we're making fun of them. And furthermore, pragmatically, I think it's going to hold us back from getting where we want to get for the next election 2.5 years from now.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. This is just wonderful conversation from the two of you. I liked very much the comment about the Episcopal Church kind of being the middle way, and I'd like to think that one of the strengths of the Episcopal Church is that we permit a wide divergence of views on many topics, including worship. And that gets me to ask my actual question, which is, how do you suppose those of us who are on an individual spiritual path, and I think that's probably everybody in one way or another, you alluded to that early in the discussion, how can we somehow get that to infuse the larger folk, the country? Because I think you kind of alluded to that as being something of significance that's missing in our corporate lives now.
It's a good question. It's also a question that a lot of smart people are thinking about right now, about our cultural narrative and how there's this narrative of decay and catastrophe and drama, which pretty much has one metric, which it has to do with what the market said today. And then there's the way most of us lead our lives. And the fact that even if we pretend like we check our convictions and emotions and whatever's going on in our life at the door when we go to work in the morning, we don't. And millennials are calling us on that, saying, I'm not going to play that game. Really being disruptive, generatively disruptive forces in a lot of our public spaces. So I'm afraid that the answer is this simple thing that we just have to start doing it where we are. But something that's on my mind, so you have to bring that and infuse that in the spaces you inhabit. I also agree and think a lot about how do we make this other narrative that is already happening all over the place just more visible, which would also mean that those of us who are populating that can become more confident about it, right? And can feel that it's infusing something. And I don't have the answer for that yet, but I do really feel like something is happening, and I do believe in what Rilke calls holding a question. I really do believe that just as words are powerful, questions are powerful, and we don't give them nearly as much credit as we should in this culture because we think that questions are things to be answered immediately. And a really good question is going to roll around and change us. So I would say do what you are doing and be in discernment about that and be intentional about that and have some trust that it matters. But I also think all of us need to start holding this question of who are we accompanying? And how are we part of something larger? And where do we see that? And how do we make that more visible? How can we kind of start to internalize and amplify the power of this? I believe that move will quietly have an effect.
Thanks so much. I think the words other and belonging are really profound right now for me in my reaction to the election and the state we find our country and the world in. And there's a way in which my whole identity has shifted. I come from a family that almost all voted for Donald Trump. 53% of white women voted for Donald Trump. And I find myself now belonging to a tribe that largely doesn't look like I look.
That what?
That largely doesn't look the way that I look. I find my tribe in the Women's March that we did here in St. Paul of just all different hues and colors and disabilities are right next to the whole folks that were, you know, doing the sign language and all that. Anyway, just this whole sense of diversity that is now my sense of belonging. And the other is now the people that were my tribe. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, but that's been a profound piece of this puzzle for me. Mm-hmm. And I actually have hope about that rather than sadness.
Right.
But this piece about how do we dialogue with the folks that voted for Donald Trump when they're in our own family is a piece of that puzzle too.
And vice versa.
Yeah, so this does come back around to the question of hope. And hope is a long-term project, right? I mean, really, if it can't be about, you know, it can't be about this presidency or the next presidency, however dramatic those things may be. So here would be my, cosmic view of my hopefulness about us. And it's really more about our century, you know, than this year. The paradox of now is that for the first time in the history of our species, we have created the tools and the capacity to actually think and act as a species. This has never been possible. The connection we have, the interconnectedness, has happened very quickly. And I really believe that the resistance to, you know, a lot of it is turning up as resistance to the other in many different forms. It's not just here, it's in Europe, it's everywhere. It's very primal, you know. That is as old as the human brain. It's as old as the oldest parts of the human brain. And it's actually very rarely, I mean, I've interviewed the people who created the science of implicit bias, which is kind of how we walk around creating patterns of categorizing, which we actually need to do to be able to go through our day and sort reality and all its complexity. But when we get scared and threatened, if the other is more more imaginary than real, right? It's a threat. It's not actually about real people or real situations. And I think that this moment globally is reactionary in the classic sense, which is it's reacting to change that is already underway, that is inevitable. And in that sense, I'm not sure we should even be that surprised. I mean, we can be alarmed at the form it's taking, and we have to work. It's, you know, it's not that damage can't be done. But really, the scope of this change and the speed of it is astonishing. For most of history, we have been oriented to care for, to see our well-being joined to our kin and tribe. And religion was really a move to open that up and to say our well-being is linked to the stranger. Our well-being is linked to the orphan and the outcast. But until now, that was a hypothetical. That was an optional assertion you could make. It's not optional anymore. Our flourishing is linked to the stranger. Our survival is linked to the stranger. And we can resist that knowledge, and you know, it's not hard to understand why people are resisting it, whose livelihood is forever changed, right? So So I think it's this paradox that we have this capacity to rise to a whole different level of being human. And yet it's happened so quickly and with such scope that it has actually sent us back to the problem of ourselves at the most base level. But I feel like if we don't start any major world wars,
yes,
and if we don't lose the rule of law, those are, big ones.
And the climate.
I mean, that, we've already been on that path. But there is possibility in this moment. And again, we're activated by this crisis. We're activated in a way we weren't 6 months ago. So can we stick with that? And can we accompany each other in sticking with that? Can we kind of hold each other accountable? Because it is hard. It's really stressful right now. Everybody's stressed out. One of my favorite teachers is Matthew Sanford, who's a yoga teacher here. And he said, we were having a conversation, I think it was before the election, but he said, everybody's hearts are a little broken right now. All our hearts are a little broken right now. And he said, the people who are filled with hate, their hearts are broken too.
I'm a Universalist Unitarian, but I still identify quite a bit with the whole growing group of people who are categorize themselves as none. And when we talk about activating young people and seeing people around us who are activated, I think a lot of people my age and older and who belong to any faith feel like their faith communities, I know I feel this way, are a place to feel they can grow and find that quiet space and be spiritually accepted in whatever way that is. And I wonder what you feel like is out there for those 20 to 25%, I don't know what it is, of people, especially young people, who identify themselves as not being part of a faith community, perhaps spiritual, but not having a faith. And how do they find those spaces, and how do we make sure those spaces are, not so insulated?
Yeah.
Right? So I worry about that.
I don't think you need to worry about them. I'm here to say, we are working with some people who are based at Harvard Divinity School, who themselves are nuns who went to Divinity School. There's a lot of that. Who are kind of mapping this world of how these new generations are finding spiritual community, spiritual life, and spiritual community. And it's more like 30 to 40% now of people under 30. And I don't think we should be shocked by that if we recall that the 80s and 90s, when these people were coming into awareness, was the era of Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson. It was the era of, and not, it wasn't just Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson, it was also journalists who handed over the microphone and the cameras to these very strident, entertaining voices who fit really well into kind of a political format of we'll duke it out and call each other names. But they didn't just call somebody wrong, they called them evil. And it was toxic for other Christians and other religious people. And the now we see these generations growing up who had that all around them, who are reasonably wary of religious affiliation and any kind, religious conviction.
And I was wondering, what are you doing to mentor the person who's going to take over from you?
Journalism, and even public radio, it's not a very hospitable place. And and I didn't really have people. I had mentors, but they weren't in my field. And I found that really disappointing and hard. And so I made a vow back then that I would be available. There's not just one person who succeeds me, but a kind of ecosystem coming up. And just what I can tell you is that I and my team, that we get contacted, and it's happening more and more by young journalists. Even I was interviewed for Time magazine back in December, and the journalist interviewed me, came out to do the interview, and she's in her mid-30s and wanted to have this conversation about wanting to reform journalism and wanting to revive the form of journalism and you know, wanting to incorporate some of these qualities that we've been able to dare in kind of a privileged format, right? I mean, having a one-hour weekly show, we're not beholden to the news cycle. In fact, we don't do the news cycle. We let other people do the news cycle. But, you know, I mean, we're hearing from people who are also inside those traditional forms saying we need more. And they personally want it to be more nourishing. Right? Not just nourishing for them, but nourishing culturally. I think the short answer, right now the whole, the new media Wild West is podcasting. And it's amazing to be, the business model that I had to create my show in at that time as part of Minnesota Public Radio, American Public Media, The flagship public radio organizations, Minnesota Public Radio is wonderful, so I don't want to... but they serve radio stations. They don't serve the world. They do serve the world, but secondarily. Mm-hmm. And in a place like Minnesota, where Minnesota Public Radio is so vibrant, you know, the service is profound. That's not true in every place. And as a producer, what's so amazing about podcasting is that now, for the first time, you're allowed to have this absolutely direct and intimate relationship with the listener. And you're not just with them. And I mean, you know, there's a magic to radio, so I get that too, and I love that. But it may not be happening because they have the radio on. It may be happening because they're running or falling asleep at night or... doing their, painting or, so people take you with them, and then the listening is very dedicated. So anyway, we're hearing from a lot of young people who are creating podcasts, people young and old who are creating podcasts, and have decided that we really are going to make ourselves available. And we actually have had to have the conversation recently about that we're not always going to be able to say yes, because this is labor intensive, but it feels really important. So I think I'm doing the best I can.
Thank you. That's a good project.